Well, okay, it seems to me that it is time to start our first lecture. And well, good day, good morning, good afternoon. Hi to everybody who joined us to this nice new mini course on combinatorial topics in low dimensional topology and geometry. This course will be given by Alexander Medne. And actually, I know Alexander many years, because in the past he was one of those who teach me at Omsk State University. And now it is really great pleasure for me to introduce his first lecture, which is about geometry of knots and links. And the floor is yours, Alexander.
Okay, Elena, thank you very much for kind invitation to give a talk on this lectorium. So today my subject will be geometry of knots and links. And so I want to say that it's a pleasure to see all participants of this lectorium. I saw many old friends. I hope to see a new one. And essentially, this is very important. We have a lot of young people who joined us in this lectorium. Okay. I start with some well-known things related with three-dimensional geometry. First of all, everybody knows what is it Euclidean three-dimensional geometry. Everybody learned it from school, from university, or just know because we are essentially living in three-dimensional geometry. From geometrical point of view, this is just Euclidean geometry, or maybe this is a Riemannian space whose metric, sectional metric, is constant and is equal to zero in each point. More complicated definition, but probably more easy for school definition, what is Euclidean geometry. Spherical geometry is a bit more complicated. In this case, every time we have a sectional curvature of constant curvature k greater than zero. Again, k is just fixed constant. This geometry was integrated by Riemann and other people. One more, maybe the most important geometry, this is hyperbolic geometry. It admits a sectional curvature of the negative curvature, negative constant curvature K, and it was independently discovered by Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky, Janosch Bayari, and probably many other mathematicians in all countries. I just managed these two important persons who indeed produce a lot of investigation related with this geometry. Now I should also mention that in three-dimensional space there are indeed eight geometries, so-called eight geometries by William Thurston. Three of them are already mentioned. Two more can be constructed more or less in easy way. This, for example, is just a direct product of two-dimensional sphere above real line. Another one is just a direct product of the hyperbolic plane by direct one. And also there are three so-called exotic geometries, nil, saw, and universal covering of the matrix group formed by two matrices with real coefficients. My subjects will be just geometries of the constant curvature, but I'm pretty sure that all methods which are developed in this lecture can be also applied to other Thurston geometries as well. Also, probably many people who joined us in this lecture knows, at least they heard about Thurston geometrical conjecture. It told us that any three-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds can be decomposed into pieces in such a way that each of these pieces can be modeled in one of the H above mentioned geometries. This conjecture was completely solved by Russian mathematician Grigory Perelman in 2003. And as a consequence of this solution, he proved the famous Poincaré conjecture. Any close three-dimensional manifold with the trivial fundamental group is the sphere. So, as I already told you, I prefer to deal only with three geometries of the constant curvature, namely Euclidean, spherical, and geometry. And my aim is to consider a special kind of links and knots which are embedded in one of these spaces in some very particular way. Okay, to do this, I want just to give a very naive definition of what is con-manifold. In my lecture, con-manifold every time is a pair formed by the three-dimensional sphere and a subset sigma, which indeed is formed by knot or link sitting inside of the three-dimensional sphere. Link means just knot with a few components. In my consideration, I prefer to endorse the complement to this knot or link by Riemannian metric of the constant sectional curvature, K, which is usually zero, plus one, or minus one. Essentially, in the case of curvature plus one, I call this situation spherical. If the curvature is minus one, I call that we have a hyperbolic structure, and the k equal to zero, I prefer to call about the Euclidean structure. What happens with the sphere itself? We should be very careful looking at this definition. This metric cannot be extended in general to all three-dimensional sphere. It's impossible. So we can consider the complement to the knot or link as a non-complete metric spaces. But if we have a metric space with some non-complete metric, every time we're able to create a completion of this metric, to create in one special way a complete metric space, which is just a sense the continuation of our original closure. This continuation is exactly con-manifold under consideration. In our particular situation, this con-manifold is topologically three-dimensional sphere, and inside of this topological three-dimensional sphere, we're able to recognize our original knot sigma, and now it became as a collection of the singular geodesic with prescribed cone angle around each of the component. This means if we are going to walk around the component of the knot, the angle around this knot is not necessarily equal to pi. Sometimes it's less than 2 pi and sometimes greater than 2 pi. Certainly, I prefer to show this on some examples. This is the first example I want to deal with. On the left side, I want to draw a spherical tetrahedra. This is a special kind of spherical tetrahedra. It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 edges, like usual tetrahedra. And essentially, he has also dihedral angles. The angles in the edge labeled by red is supposed to be alpha. Dihedral angle in the edge formed by blue edge is supposed to be beta. There are four black edges remained. All of them are supposed to give to have dihedral angles pi over 2. Now I want to produce one very special operation. I want to identify the faces of this tetrahedra in couples. By rotation on the angle alpha, I want to identify two faces with common edge colored by red. Also, by the same procedure, by beta rotation, I want to identify two faces with common edges labeled by blue one. As a result, if we carefully produce this procedure, we're able to understand under beta rotation, the edge of the red color became a circle, because beta rotation identifies the endpoints of this edge. Again, in the case of rotation by angle alpha, we are able to identify the edge point of the blue edge. As a result, we have two different circles. One of them is red, and another one is blue one. Together, they form so-called link. Coupling. Also, if you are looking about geometrical structure, we are able to recognize the total angle around the red edge now is alpha, which is not necessary to pi. And again, total angle around blue one is equal to beta. After identification, just looking on the topology, we're able to recognize that our polyhedra now became just a three-dimensional sphere. As a result, we have so-called Hopling manifold with cone angles alpha and beta. I should say that this construction is possible for arbitrary positive alpha and beta. They may be even sufficiently large. Okay, now I want to switch to the following subject, how to calculate the volume of the obtained cone manifold. I should say that all construction can be done in the spherical geometry. So because of this, I'm talking about spherical volume only. To calculate the volume of cone manifold of constant curvature, in our case, constant curvature is plus one, we have to use so-called Schlafly differential formula. This is exactly the formula we want to use. K times dV is not Carpe-Vries equation. This is just constant K times differential of volume. This is exactly equal half of sum, where sum is taken over all components of our knot or links. L sub alpha is the length of the component, and alpha is a conical angle of this component. For example, in our particular case of the hop link, we introduce a metric of curvature plus one. This was already agreement before. And just looking on the picture, we are able to recognize that the link with cone angle alpha has a length equal to beta. And conversely, if the link has a cone angle beta, his length is alpha. As a result, we are able to form the differential of volume for our cone manifold. This is just the following differential form. After integration, we have alpha times beta over 2 plus constant of integration. But one can easily recognize if both angles, alpha and beta, are sufficiently small, we are going to create a very, very flat tetrahedra. So its volume essentially is going to the zero. This means that the constant of integration for sure is equal to zero. So we have the first formula for the spherical volume of Kuhn manifold. Okay, are there some questions? We can continue. Okay. The next link or not under consideration will be the so-called trefoil group. It is shown on this picture. Again, we suppose that it can be realized in the spherical geometry inside of three-dimensional sphere in such a way that outside of this link, everywhere, the curvature of our space is plus one. But on the link, the curvature has a problem. There are no Riemannian structure anymore, but we have just a geodesic in this situation. This geodesic allowed us to give angle around the trefoil knot equal to alpha. Now we want to investigate which angle are sufficient to get, for example, spherical geometry or maybe another geometry as well. Usually people who are doing with knot theory do not like trefoil, because on the complement of the trefoil, according to the Thurston theorem, never one can get a hyperbolic structure. It's not admit a hyperbolic structure at all. But at the same time, sooner or later, it was discovered that this complement admit two other three-dimensional geometry, different three-dimensional geometry. So this, in some sense, it's a very rich geometrical space as well. In the same time, a long time ago, in the paper of Seifert and Weber, they constructed so-called spherical space of dodecahedra, also known as the Poincaré homological sphere. This space can be indeed be realized as a five-fold covering of the three-dimensional sphere branch exactly over trefoil. In our language, this means that Kuhn manifold 3-1, this is just another notion for trefoil, with Kuhn angle 2 pi over 5 every time has a spherical structure. Why this Poincaré homology sphere is so important? Indeed, a long time ago, when Poincaré tried to form the first version of the Poincaré hypothesis, he asked, suppose that the first homology of the closed three-dimensional manifold is equal to zero. Is this true that this manifold is the three-dimensional sphere? Soon or later, Poincaré himself constructed a counterexample to his first hypothesis. This is exactly Poincaré sphere, or maybe spherical space of dodecahedra. Why dodecahedra? You can realize dodecahedra. Dodecahedra is a polyhedra which consists of pentagons. You need exactly 12 pentagons to create a dodecahedra. Then the opposite faces of this dodecahedra can be identified in pairs to get exactly this Seifert-Weber manifold. You should be careful, because this kind of the dodecahedra supposed to be realized in the spherical space. This means that the Kuhn angle of this dodecahedra is quite big. It's supposed to be 2 pi over 3. So in some sense, this is just something more bigger than as usual ball. Okay, let me continue our consideration. It can be showed that if angle alpha is in some limits, for example, between pi over 3 and 5 pi over 3, then the trefoil Kuhn manifold for sure admit a spherical structure. Moreover, the volume of this spherical structure is given by the following simple formula. This is just order 2 polynomial with respect to alpha. I indicate very briefly to proof of this statement. To do this, I want to realize the three-dimensional sphere S3 as a unit sphere in the complex two-dimensional space, complex two-dimensional space, four-dimensional real space, and endowed this space by the following Hermitian metric. Lambda is a special positive parameter which depends from our angle. One can check that as a result, with this a bit strange metric, the unit sphere in the complex space indeed is a spherical space of the constant curvature plus one. So this is standard three-dimensional sphere realized in some very strange way. But now we are able to construct a fundamental set for our polyhedra. How to do this? Easy. We want to consider just the following polyhedra. It consists of four curvilinear faces, which are shown in my picture. And my idea is just to identify these curvilinear faces in pairs by making use of two rotations, namely rotation of A and rotation of B. Both rotations are produced by a rotation on angle alpha. As a result, by more or less elementary calculation, we are able to find the coordinates of faces of this polyhedra in two-dimensional complex space. This is just very simple complex number. So to find the length of our V-naught, which now is formed by two diagonals, I want to calculate the length of each of these diagonals. We know the coordinates of vertices very explicitly. This is good news. And also we know the metric. This Hermitian metric was already done. It has a bit strange, but very simple form. So we are able to calculate. We are able to calculate these lengths very, very explicitly. As a result, the total length of our links, which is just sum of lengths of two diagonals, is 3 alpha minus pi. Again, by Schlafly formula, we are able to integrate very simple differential form. Again, some very special argument close to those made in the previous consideration of the Hopling make us sure that constant of integration every time is zero. As a result, after the integration, we have the simple volume formula as well. Okay. Now, another knot, also quite known. This is so-called the figure eight knot. We should say that in well-known Thurston lecture, it was shown the complement on this figure eight knot can be decomposed in the union of two copies of the regular ideal tetra in the hyperbolic free space. This means that the complement of the knot for sure admits a complete hyperbolic structure. I should say that existence of the complete hyperbolic structure on the complement of figure knot indeed was proved a bit early by a British mathematician who indeed was born in the United States by Robert Riley in his published manuscript. Now, what about volumes of the figure eight knot? This volume was calculated in our paper joined with my former student Alexey Raskazov, and we have the following results. In hyperbolic geometry, this is exactly the case when con angle is between 0 and 2π/3. We have the following simple formula for calculations of volume. In spherical case, we have to choose the length of knot as a unit of the length in the Euclidean free space. As a result, we also have quite simple consideration for the volume. Hyperbolic space and spherical usually are quite similar to each other. So in the spherical case, the formula can be obtained from the previous one if we change R cos hyperbolic by R cos in usual sense. For small alpha, this is just very simple formula. For large angle alpha, we have to take another analytical branch of the multivalued analytical function R cos. As a result, after integration by parts, we have just a simple formula for the volume as well. Okay, so this was done a long time ago. And question how to calculate hyperbolic and spherical and Euclidean volume for more complicated link of knot was indeed open for a long time. How to solve this problem in more or less general situation? I tried to explain just now by making use of this simple picture. On the first picture, on the left, I just consider a unit cube living in the Euclidean three-dimensional space. Also, I prefer to delete each face of this cube by half, by this red, blue, and green lines. Now, because each of faces of the cube is already divided into pieces, I am able to produce pi rotation to identify halves of a face in each case. This is like a close the book. So we have to close the book at least six times. This is the number of faces of the cube. As a result, we obtained a link consisting of three components, red component, blue component, and green one. All of them are singular geodesic with cone angle around equal to pi. It's easy to understand because all times we have used pi rotation. The total space, as before in some previous examples, give us a three-dimensional sphere. So we have a cone manifold whose underlying space is this three-dimensional sphere and whose singular set is formed by so-called Borromean rings. There are three components. Everything is done by making use of Euclidean geometry only. Now, everybody can recognize that dodecahedra on the right and cube on the left topologically and combinatorically are the same picture. This is just slight modification. Indeed, when the face of the cube is divided in two pieces, each piece gives us a pentagon. Easy calculate, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sides in each space. Now we are able to modify our picture slightly by making use of rotation on angle lambda, mu, or maybe nu. As a result, we have similar construction. Topologically and combinatorically, nothing changed. So after the identification of the faces in the same manner, we have again a cone manifold whose singular set is Borromean ring, but the cone angle now are different. They are lambda, mu, and nu, correspondingly of the choice of our consideration. In different geometries, this construction can be realized geometrically. But in all cases, we can easily recognize by making use of reflection in three mutually orthogonal planes, we are able to divide our dodecahedra in 8 copies of the cube, small cube. 8 copies of the cube give us a dodecahedra or maybe big cube, which was the starting point of our consideration. What about the angles of this stretch cube? Black angles every time are equal, dihedral angles in black edges are equal to pi over 2. Dihedral angles in the color angles are respectively lambda over 2, mu over 2, and mu over 2. This guy is usually called Lambert cube. It was discovered by Lambert more or less in the same time when Lobachevsky and Bayer discovered their geometry. Lambert indeed almost discovered non-Euclidean geometry. He was very close, but he has a mistake. He was trying to prove the first postulate of the Euclidean positive way. It was his mistake. But he constructed a counterexample. This guy, Lambert cube, is exactly very excellent counterexample to the fifth postulate of Euclid. Okay, now I am able to forget about link at all, because the construction which give us a link indeed now is decomposed in 8 equal copies of the Lambert cube with so-called essential angles alpha, beta, and gamma. Indeed, alpha is just mu over 2, beta is just lambda over 2, and gamma is mu over 2. There are some existence theorem. If angles are small, then this cube together with Baramean rings can be realized in the hyperbolic geometry. If all of them are equal to pi over 2, of course, the Euclidean geometry. This was starting point. And for large angles, this construction can be realized in the spherical space. Now we want to calculate the volume. Again, I want to use Schlafly formula. Schlafly formula gives answer immediately if we are able to integrate the following Schlafly differential form. Well, what means integrate? This means that we want to find a function v, which is function of three variables, alpha, beta, and gamma. And this function satisfied to the following system of the ordinary differential equation. This is just partial derivative, and this is just initial data. So we have a classical Cauchy problem for the system of linear differential equation. If we find a solution of the system, it's already unique. So we are able to prove our theorem related to the volume of Lambert cube. Okay, to do this immediately, to do this directly, this is quite difficult problem. So I want to find the geometrical approach to solve this problem completely. For this purpose, I want to introduce three different kinds of theory. The first, this is so-called tangent theory. They related to dihedral angles of the Lambert cube and its lengths in hyperbolic geometry. We have a very, very beautiful tangent theory. Indeed, it was discovered in some way in the PhD thesis of Ruth Kelleher-Hatz, but when I show this statement in her PhD thesis, it was slightly surprising, because she was thinking about this tangent theorem as a, some special statement. Well, later, three more different rules can be added to the statement. This is so-called sine cosine rule discovered in our joint paper with Dima Derevnin, written a long time ago. There are three different equations because cyclic imitation of alpha, beta, and gamma every time gives them the mass. One more relation was known for a long time. This is a paper of Hilden, Lozano, and Montesinos, probably well known to many people who are doing with three-dimensional topology and geometry. In this case, alpha, beta, A, B, C are just tangent of our angles respectively. They produce this very strange algebraic equation. The purpose of our integration was completely different from ours. They want to find a condition when all default based on the Borel mean risk is arithmetical, so can be represented in some way by integer matrices, but maybe of the very, very large size. They investigated this question completely, but in the end of their paper, they put this equation. Then it was a comment. We don't know how to solve this equation because it's order six equation. But indeed, one can easily recognize that it has at least one evident truth. T is equal plus or minus imaginary units, plus minus I. So this means that this equation can be decomposed into easy equations. Because T is positive parameter, we never use the root equal to plus minus I. So T indeed is a root of some big quadratic equation, which is easy to solve. This means that sooner or later we are able to find this T very explicitly. But we don't need to do this, but it's just for full information about geometrical structure of the Borel mean ring. Now we are able to calculate the volume. We just get the formula, which are coming from the paper of Hilden, Lamazam, and Zinas, put logarithm for this formula and integrate in some special way. I claim that as a result, we have a formula for hyperbolic Lambert cube. Now there are sufficiently place to give a complete proof for this statement. Indeed, what we have to do? We have to show that the Schlafly equation is satisfied. This means that the partial derivative of the volume formula with respect to alpha supposed to be equal to minus length over two. How to prove this? We just differentiate this integral expression. This is just quite elementary things, because soon or later we are able to find this derivative very explicitly. This is just minus half of the arctangent A over two. By the tangent rule, which was already mentioned before, this is exactly minus L over R, exactly what we want to prove. In a similar way, we have to obtain the two formula for angles beta and gamma. Now, for uniqueness of our formula, we have to verify the initial data. It was the initial data of this type. But one can easy to understand if alpha, beta, and gamma are going to pi over two, T, this T, is going to the infinity. So the last condition is equivalent to the convergence of our integral. But this again, very elementary task in the analysis to prove that this integral converges on the infinity. So everything is done. We show that this strange integral expression satisfies the Schlafly equation. So this is a volume indeed. Now maybe some secret. Why it was done so quickly, how we were able to predict the volume formula. Okay, indeed, what we need to do for calculation of volume, we need to integrate the following differential form. Ignore the coefficient minus one over two. In our notation, by making use of tangent of angle and tangent of length, we are able to recognize that this form is exactly this differential form. Okay, T is quite complicated guy. I even don't remember how it looks. This is just root of some big quadratic equation. But now, for the moment, we suppose that T is just an independent variable. And because of this, I am able to add one more term to our differential form. Now we have four terms. The last one, F capital, is unknown for the moment. But what kinds of condition we are able to suppose? Certainly the differential of the formula is equal to zero. After this, we have to understand that the condition differential is equal to zero indeed is equivalent to the following simple expressions. Easy to find partial derivative of the arctangent hyperbolic. After doing this, we're able to integrate these three equations in very easy ways and recognize that up to constant of integration, it has just unique solution. This is actually the function which we use to calculate the volume of our polyhedra. Minus 1/2 certainly should be added to this construction, but it is all the elementary things. So this is just a suggestion that this function is responsible for the volume, but the proof, complete proof that this formula is a volume formula gives was done before. So this is a trick well known for a long time from the old papers of the German mathematicians. The next link or not, this is not 5.2. This is shown off the picture. Probably I avoid some history of the question. This history is quite big. And I want just to say that as a, in the case of the figure 8 node, we're able to find the condition when the Kohn manifold based on this node is hyperbolic. This is happens if angle is between 0 and alpha 0, where alpha 0 is very explicit value, whose cotangent, cotangent half of this angle is given by very explicit formula. For the particular value alpha equal to alpha 0, we have a Euclidean structure. And for large alpha, as before, we have a spherical structure. So this is just existence theory. In different time, it was done by different people. I just want to mention a few names, the people who are responsible for this kind of result. But my aim, again, is just find the way how to calculate the volume. The first result was done some times ago. In the hyperbolic case, when alpha is sufficiently small, we have a hyperbolic structure, and the volume of this hyperbolic structure is given by the following complex integral. I just imaginary unit. Z and Z bar are complex conjugated root of the same cubic equation. This cubic equation is shown on my slide. I already explained to you how to predict this formula from the very beginning. You have to use also some artificial calculations similar to those I show you. Just predict the direct proof of the formula is given by making use of the Schlafly formula again. Spherical case. Spherical case was unknown for a long time. This is just a recent result obtained 1 year ago. If angle alpha is sufficiently big, we have a spherical structure, and the volume of the spherical structure is given essentially by the same integral. Imaginary I disappeared. Z1 and Z2 are the root of the same cubic equation. But now they both are a real root of the same equation. Because there are three different roots, we have to choose only two of them. This is condition to choose this root correctly. Then we have a volume formula. For large angles, we have to integrate this formula by parts. I avoid the details in this case. What was the main idea to prove this formula, for example, is spherical case. It was never done before. It's very strange. Sometimes ago, a lot of people which were interested in hyperbolic geometry discovered so-called a polynomial related of the complex length of the node and its Kohn angles in the following way. So this is polynomial with integer coefficient, but usually it's very, very, very large polynomial. In our case, which up to our knowledge never used before, we want to use this a polynomial in spherical case. In this case, we slightly modified this L capital and M capital. M essentially is the same. It's responsible for the cone angle. L has a slightly different structure. There are no any more complex lenses. We have just a true lens, spherical lens of our knot, and so call it angle of rotation, which indeed I never use in central way, but it's supposed to be here. Then the main idea that we can to use essentially the same R polynomial for this kind of equation. Now, I want to prove spherical formula for the 5-2 knot. Before to do this, I want to introduce so-called cotangent rule. Remember, before it was tangent rule, now it's cotangent. It relates together the spherical length of the knot, cone angles, and the angle of rotation around the knot. This is so-called angles of the lifting homology. Very surprisingly, but the product of these cotangents is again the root of the same cubic equation as before. How to prove this? This essentially is a trigonometrical form of a polynomial equation. A polynomial equation is quite big, but if we introduce just trigonometrical function in the manner shown on the slide, we have a very, very simple of a polynomial equation, namely this one. Now I am able to prove the volume formula in spherical case very precisely. By our assumption, the volume in spherical case is given by the following function, where F capital is just given by the following rational expression. What we have to do? We have to show that the partial derivative with respect to alpha is plus L over two. This is spherical geometry. And some initial data, which can be also easily satisfied. Now I want to prove that the partial derivative indeed is L over two. How to do this? Directly. First of all, this is a just standard formula, how to find partial derivative of integral that depends from parameter. Z1 and Z2 are just limits of integration. They are chosen in such a way that they are root of the integrand. This means that this strange expression with logarithms are equal to zero, indeed, they disappeared. Only one integral expression remains to be. But this is just integral, which everybody knows how to calculate from the elementary school. This is our cotangent of this quotient, and another one is our cotangent of the second quotient. Now is good time to use our cotangent theorem. By cotangent theorem, this first expression is just this linear combination, and the second expression is another linear combination. The difference of these two expressions is exactly L alpha over two. I checked this million times, so I saw that everything is correct. Now we are able to prove the Schlaffe formula. Initial data can be shown also in some elementary way, but it's just much more easy to do with respect to the differential. So the main tool again will cotangent theorem, which in our case is just a trigonometrical version of a polynomial equation. Now, more delicate questions. How to calculate the Euclidean volume? Euclidean volume indeed is the most difficult one, because to find the Euclidean volume, we have to make a limit motion from hyperbolic geometry, or maybe from spherical geometry. Euclidean geometry is between these two guys. This statement, we suppose L alpha zero is the length of our knot modeled in the Euclidean geometry. Why we have to do this? This is a strange situation. To calculate the volume in the ordinary Euclidean space is a bit delicate problem. First of all, you have to fix a scale the unit of length. What is the unit of length in the knot theory? Yes, more or less evidently that the length of our knot supposed to be as a unit. As a result, we have to use just so-called specific volume, or maybe average volume. I don't know. This depends from the point of view. And our theorem tells that exactly for this particular value, the Kohn manifold based on the Fahrenheit 2 knot has a Euclidean structure. The volume of this Euclidean structure calculated by conditions that the unit of the length is the length of knot itself is given by the following elementary expression. It's given very explicit. Also, I am able to give a proof of this guy. Because we have to make a limit, for example, from the hyperbolic geometry, we have to know that the volume of hyperbolic Kohn manifold is going to zero, and length itself is going to zero when alpha is going to alpha zero. So to find the limit, we have to use so-called L'Hopital rule. Okay, derivative of volume by Schlafly formula is minus L over 2. The derivative of polynomial can be easy to find. As a result, we have to find just the following more or less elementary limit. Because we have some algebraic equation which are responsible for the length of our knot, we are able to produce just some analytical calculations which are able to find the limit of this analytical function. As a result, we have exactly this expression. This is quite general fact, indeed. It was shown in our paper, joined with my former students, Nikolai Abrosimov and Sasha Kalpakov, that this is general rule. Every time when we are looking for the specific Euclidean volume, we want to have an algebraic number. So the specific volume every time is a root of algebraic equation with integer coefficients. This is just list of links or knots up to 7 crossing. This is exactly the angle when the knot has a Euclidean structure. And this is a Euclidean volume. 2 cases are already shown, namely the case of the figure 8 knot, is the case of the 5-2 knot. But all these numbers are algebraic. Every time we're able to find an algebraic equation, which are responsible for this number. And last, I want to return back again to the spherical geometry and just investigate the behavior of formulas which are already shown in my lecture. In the case of the hop link, we have just the following formula for the volume. In the trefoil knot case, another one. And we should know the following elementary fact. Let me suppose for the moment that Kohn angles alpha and beta are rational multiples of pi. So are given just expression pi times rational number. In this case, all volumes are rational multiple of pi squared. For Borromean rings, which also were investigated, Borromean rings were formed by Lambert cube, we have more complicated relations. For this particular angles, which of course are rational multiple of pi, we have a volume which are rational multiple of pi squared. As a result, we are able to produce the rational volume conjecture. Suppose that knot or link is modeled in spherical geometry and its Kohn angles are rational multiple of pi. Then its spherical volume is a rational multiple of pi squared. There are many examples which shows this is true. And all cases when I'm able to calculate the volume explicitly, this for sure is true. But in this moment, I have no idea how to prove this conjecture explicitly. Probably this more or less all what I want to say today, and this is just literature. which is related with the subject of my lecture. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Alexander, for a very nice talk. Are there any questions to the speaker? Well, if not, then let me ask. Well, actually, it seems that it is tricky enough to find volumes of knots, right? So in each specific case, you need to apply some specific approach and to use some specific methods. Is it true? Or if not, then maybe there are something like a general approach which can be used to any kind of knot.
This is a good question. Generally, of course, if you are looking to start with so-called a polynomial, which was mentioned before, every time we want to use some algebraic function. Usually this algebraic function is quite complicated. Even for simple links and knots, to find this function explicitly, this is very, very difficult technical problem. So my aim was to avoid this algebraic function calculations. And surprisingly, the reason was just trigonometrical equation, trigonometrical identities, which is well known from the school. We have to use tangent rule, sine rule, cosine rule, which more or less understandable for everybody. And surprisingly, but in this case, we have much more simple algebraic equation with integer coefficients and so on. Of course, maybe this is not general approach. Now we try to do this for knots with one complement, with two complements, with three components. It works perfectly. But in general, of course, the equations under consideration became more and more complicated. So sooner or later, we have to stop. But at least for the large list of links, we are succeeded. We have explicit formula. And also we are able to understand the geometrical structure of links. We are able to calculate the lenses if we know the angles and back, calculate the volume to calculate another invariance like Chern-Simons invariance and so on. So for if links are not so complicated, say up to 7 crossing, everything can be done by hand. Otherwise, we have to introduce quite complicated algebraic functions. Of course, this idea still works, but calculation probably will be too complicated as well. So
this is the question. But you said that the volume can be obtained by hand. Does this mean that the numbers you used in the table, they use by hand?
In our case, we have just very explicit volume formula in terms of integrals. Yes, of course, you can calculate just elementary the numbers. But of course, to check that the result is correct or maybe to find another approach, we have to use another computer programs. There are many of them. The first one was created by Jeffrey Weeks a long time ago. If we draw the link or not in the computer, computer immediately give us the answer. What is the hyperbolic volume of your node. But there are no program which able us to calculate the spherical volume. And I never saw the program which calculates the Euclidean volume. Even I don't know the people who show me how to calculate the Euclidean volume. This is just very new result obtained in my paper 2 years ago. This is the second paper in my list.
But why it is so important to know the volumes of these links and
nodes? This is one of the natural invariants because, for example, in hyperbolic in spherical geometry, if two con manifolds are combinatorically equivalent in some way, they have the same volume. So this is rigid. So this is some rigid invariant. It's indeed topological invariant, combinatorial invariant. Easy to calculate, but this has a combinatorial sense.
In some sense, it can be used as a topological invariant for these
nodes. No, yes, for sure, it's kind of invariant, very important invariant for the node link. but also it helps us to understand the geometrical structure of this three-dimensional object, how it's large, how the volume is related with lenses. There are some inequalities, isoparametric inequalities, which can be done also for knots and links as well.
I see. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Are there any other questions to Alexander? Well, if not, then let us thank again. Thank you very much. It was very interesting lecture. And in 2 weeks, there will be one more lecture. Let me have a look on our scheduler. So the lecture 2 will be about polyhedra in spaces of constant curvature, right?
Yeah.
Okay, then see you in 2 weeks. Thank you very much.
Thank you.